Hello, Life Church. Can you hear me? I see Serena. I see Pastor Dan. Let me see if I can get a better picture in here. All right. Can you hear me? Good morning, Pastor B, Hannah, Dawn. All right. We're going to wait a few more minutes, let people get on board here. Then we're going to start the message. Short message today. Everybody enjoying this good, cold, sleet, rainy weather? Man. Like everybody's coming on. All right. We'll give everybody a few more minutes here. Make sure everybody's here. Good morning, Dwayne, Jasmine, T. What's up, girl? Hey, Sally, how we doing this morning? I'm just going to sit here and look like an oddball until everybody gets on. Is that okay? Yeah, all ice, no snow. You can build an ice man. I don't know what you do with an ice man, but you can make one. Trying to get a good picture where I ain't having a look up like this to see you. I can see you straight ahead. Yes. Milk and bread sandwiches. What is that? That's got to be gross, man. Was he just dipping milk in the bread in his milk, or is he putting the bread in his milk and then eating it? Of course, anything can come from a Florida state, man. They eat weird stuff anyway. All right. Well, it's 10:32. How many are ready to get into the Word this morning? If you are, give me a like if you're ready. There's one, there's two, three, four, five, six. I guess everybody's ready to get into the Word. All right. Go, Serena. Go, girl. Go, girl. Well, today I want to continue to talk about evangelism. God's really got evangelism on my heart, big time. And be ready the next week to 2 weeks. We're going to be giving some ideas. We're going to be looking at some things that we're going to do to get the church outside the building. At the same time, getting people inside the building. So, it's going to be interesting. So, just get ready. You're going to be hearing a little bit about it next week. But, it's going to be a great time. What God is doing, the vision that He's given us. And we're just going to move forward what He has for us. Amen. We're ready to go. So, Father, right now, in Jesus' name, I just ask that you guide and direct us through this teaching today, Father. Lord, I just thank you what you placed in my heart, Lord. Lord, we as a church have got to begin to get more involved in evangelism, Father God. It's not enough just to think about it. Lord, we got to become the doers of the word that you tell us to. And so, Lord, I just thank you for what you're going to do this morning that's going to turn us in from being hearers and doers of the word that brings glory and honor to you. Lord, if there's any out there today that are sick, Father God, we just pray total healing in their bodies right now, Father. And Lord, I just love you. I praise you and I glorify you for what you're going to be doing in each one of our hearts. Guide me through this teaching, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. like I said, I'm going to continue on evangelism. I had a message I was going to do at church this morning, but I want to save that for next Sunday because it's something I'm going to be telling you about in a few minutes about it, about next Sunday. But I sat down and God just began to show me some stuff and began to do some studying and looked at some things. And I'm thinking, Lord, we have got to become an evangelic church, Father God. One, a church that is truly evangelizing their community. And because I personally believe that our culture is changing. Our culture, I believe, is becoming more and more secular in the world. And I think because Christians have become less concerned about the lost and less concerned about the commandment that Jesus gave us, that he gave the church in Matthew 28, when he said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And I think sometimes we leave out that last part that's so important, where Jesus says, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. I believe with all my heart, church, we have got to become radical Christians again. Christians that's ready to worship God, not just come into the church and raise our hands, but come into our church and raise some radical hands lifted up to God, some radical voices coming forward, that we go out as radical Christians that is ready to turn this world upside down like the disciples did 2,000 years ago. We've got to get back to that. We've got to get back to the excitement in the church, not just enough to come to the church and hear a message or a song, but to get in there and really want God's heart to be in our hearts, to have his desires be our desires, and to worship him, to praise him like we never have ever done. Many of us have, years ago, man, we came in the church, we were ready to praise, we were ready to worship. And it just doesn't seem like it's that way. We've got to get back to that. We got to get back to the excitement. We got to get back to the desires of God. And so next Sunday, we're going to do something a little special. Pastor Dwayne and I are going to do a message together. He's going to go first, and then I'm going to come and finish it up. So you need to make sure that you're here at church next Sunday. You don't want to miss out. I believe there's going to be such an anointing in that building, and it's just going to be exciting. So you don't want to miss out next Sunday, what we got planned, what God has put in our hearts, and how all this, how my message turned out to work flow with the message he gave us this past Wednesday night. And we just need to hear that word that's going to come forth. So I encourage you, don't just watch it on the video. You got to be there in present, in person, to receive all that God wants you to have next Sunday. So make sure you're there. Getting back to the message. Let me ask you a question. I like asking questions. Do you believe that it's harder today for people to believe in Christianity? Because this is what we call secularism. You know, in Europe, probably 500 years ago, it was pretty much impossible not to believe in God. I mean, you wouldn't even think of having a life that was apart from God. Today, in this country, in the United States, there are so many people, I believe, that could care less about being apart from God. That they say, okay, the further distance I am from God, the happier I am. You and I know people that don't share our faith. I mean, think about it. How can someone believe in a God if they're never, ever told about that God? If they're ever, never shown about that God? That God that's in us is not being shown through, and we're not getting the word out. How can we expect people to believe if they're not being told? You know, I believe some people really, really put on a good show, or maybe they're not really afraid to live in sin, or even to believe in the afterlife. You know, years and years ago, when witnessing to someone, there was two questions asked to the person that you were talking to. And many of us the older folks, we probably remember asking these questions to people. One of them is, we would ask somebody, if you were standing right now in front of God, and he asked you this one question, why should I let you into heaven? That was the question we asked. Another question is, if you were to die today, do you know if you're going to hell or to heaven? And do you remember some of the responses that we got? Yeah, I think I'll go to heaven. I mean, and they thought we could go to heaven. They could go to heaven because they were good enough. And that's all you had to do. You just had to be good. You know, I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't do this. But the problem is you've never asked Jesus Christ into your heart. But they believe just being a good person gets you into heaven. And that's not it. And I think it's so much because they don't understand the scripture that Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. And no one can go to the Father except through him. What has happened to these two questions? They were direct. They were to the point. Because they made people think. Some people didn't know what they had to do. All they thought was just being good. Today, I mean, people would debate with you. And they will give you different answers now to them questions. But the thing is, we need to ask those questions. We just have to be ready for their responses. Be ready. I mean, and we got the word down inside of us. If you're reading through the Bible through the year that we put out last year in 2021, now we're doing it again in 2022, man, that we get that word down inside of us. And if we get that word down inside of us, then what can we do? We can be ready for their responses to be able to lead them to Jesus. But we need to be careful when we hear these two words. And those two words are spiritual and religious. Spiritual is, I believe in a higher power. And it doesn't have to be God. I mean, it could be my cat. I believe in my cat being my higher power, that I get my answer from my cat. Joe Biden could be their higher power. Donald Trump could be considered their higher power. And those are not the higher power that we're talking about. You know, I did a research, and in North Carolina, 39% of the people who attend worship service at least weekly, almost three-fourths of those 39% say they believe in God with no doubts that they believe in God. Only three-quarters, that's a fourth of a quarter of the people that attend church that don't believe in God. They're just going to church so they can say they had their Sunday service and that they went to church. Of North Carolina adults, 77% are Christians. 20% of those are unaffiliated with any religion, and about 3% are non-Christian faith. The largest group is the Jewish community. This was taken back in 2017. In 2020, they took this survey. In 1990, 85% of the United States people, adults, identified themselves as Christians. 85%, that's pretty good. In 2001, it dropped down to 81.6%. In 2012, it dropped down to 78%. In 2014, it dropped down to 7.6%. In 2015, it dropped down to 75%. Today, in the United States, people who identify themselves as Christians is 65% of adults. It's dropping. It's dropping. And that's why, church, evangelism is important. That we get out. We spread the gospel. We tell people about Jesus. But let me give you some good news. In the year 2050, Christianity will still be the majority religion in the United States. Hallelujah. We will stay. But we're gradually losing numbers. And we've got to get those numbers back. We got to get back up to 85, 90%, 95%. Let me tell you, we can turn this world upside down. All it takes is one church. All it takes is one individual to get excited for Jesus, to get radical for Jesus, that when they come into the church, they're ready to go straight to that altar and just begin to praise God. They don't want to wait. They want to get into it right then. That's how radical we got to get. That we're coming to praise God. We're coming to worship God because of who He is. We got to get that radicalism back inside of us. All right, get back to the message. People will tell you that they're spiritual or religious. And the reason is they don't see any value in religion. They don't see any value in coming to church. They're spiritual. They're religious. But they have no value. I read when one pastor said that Christians have reduced God to just a set of ideas. As for example, God is the body of incarnation, yet we have excarnated Him from our evangelism. Have we taken the Word, His Word, and reduced it to only an intellectual message? Have we gotten away from telling the truth of His Word? Like, the one thing, there's more than one way to make it into the kingdom of God. No, there's not. That's a lie from hell. There's only one way. His name is Jesus Christ. He is the way, as we said before. Another lie. Oh, did Jesus really walk on water? Yes, He did. If the Word says it, I believe it. I believe what God says. And we cannot just minister to people's minds. We have got to preach to the whole person. We've got to preach to the spirit, soul, and body. We've got to get them so ready. When they respond in different ways, we've got to be ready. We're just trying to play mind games. We got to get God down into their hearts to where it really matters in our lives, in their lives. This pastor also told the story of a woman that he ran into. She was in her 60s, and she shared that she had some negative experiences with Christians. She said she said that she was not interested in being a Christian. And the other day, she was hiking up a mountain, and there was this group of women hiking up the trail as well. She says she could hear their conversation as they were hiking, and that she could tell that they were Christians. And then she thought to herself, that would be so nice to be a part of a group like that. She wished she had one. That's when the pastor told her that his church happened to have a woman hiking group. So he invited her to go on one of their hikes. And this lady wasn't looking to be involved in an argument. She wanted to be involved in a community. See, we have these Bible studies in different things. And what happens is, we don't watch out, the Bible studies become an argument place. It becomes a gossiping group instead of a Bible group, instead of getting through the Word and what God's Word is saying. We rather gossip about something. Well, it gets into that. All it takes is one person bring something up. Then you want you to know the whole group is there gossiping about this one person. And that can't happen. You can't get in an argument. You've got to stay in the faith of Jesus. You've got to let people know this is a community. It's not a gossip section. But it's a Bible study, that we're studying God's Word, and we're community, we're loving each other. That's what these Bible studies needs to be. And guess what? She went hiking with them, and she was blessed. And that's the thing. She was looking for a group that was involved in doing something together, not involved in just arguing about something, but involved with a group. See, that's the problem. We've got to get to a place where we're involved in people's lives, loving on them, hugging on them, letting them know how much Jesus loves them. And the church is the greatest resource. The church needs to be offering all these things. And that's part of evangelism, is getting people into the church and evangelizing them and going out into the world. And yes, man, wasn't it great? You know, we went hiking one time. We had a few of the couples. One, two, three, four couples went. We had a great time. We was out there just walking and up the trails and having, went and had peace afterwards. We had a great time because we were a community at that time. There's things that the church can do to be a community and not just a gossip section. And that's what God is placing on my heart. We're going to see some things happening. And we're going to be telling you about it the next two weeks. Get ready. See, we're not called to just tell people about the gospel, but to embody the gospel, to help meet people's physical needs. See, people need to see. People need to touch. People need to taste Jesus. And that taste, that touch, that seeing comes from us because we have Jesus in us. And it should come through us. That they should be able to talk to us and just feel and see the presence of God in our lives. That we're not there to argue with them. We're there to love on them. We're there to tell them more and more about Jesus. You know, the four men in Mark 2, which I'm gonna be sharing on next Sunday, along with Dwayne's part of teaching. But, you know, when they carried their paralyzed friend to the house where Jesus was teaching, and you remember it was blocked, they couldn't get in, so they went up on the roof and they lowered him down to the feet of Jesus. And that's my sermon message next Monday, is that we've got to tear a hole in the roof of the church and bring people to Jesus. Those four friends believed in the ability and the power of Jesus to heal their friend. They believed in the ability, oh man, and the power of Jesus. Church, we got to get back to that believing again. We got to get back to that. See, they activated in faith by bringing their friend to the feet of Jesus. Do we sometimes fail to have the faith in the supernatural power of Jesus? No, we don't believe Jesus can heal them. No, we don't believe Jesus can touch them. No, we don't. And we're blocking the faith that God has placed inside of us. Let me tell you, is this why evangelism isn't radical in us anymore? Because we question sometimes God. Can he? Yes, he can. Church, we got to get that down inside of us. Yes, we can believe that God has the power. God moves in the supernatural. We can. That power that can transform any non-Christian life into a Christian life. We got to believe they can do it. It is inside of us. We got to get it out. We got to love on people. We got to care about people. There is no other way. Christ in us, their hope of glory. Christ in them can be their hope of glory. We've got to get it out. You know, Jesus spoke to the people's spiritual condition. He spoke to the heart. Jesus spoke to that paralyzed man's heart first. That was his first real need. Not the healing of his legs, but he needed the healing in his heart. We're trying to go out and heal people, but we're not going out trying to get people saved. We got to get them saved. We got to get them knowing Jesus Christ. Let Jesus heal them. Let Jesus do what he's called. He wants to do. Tell people you believe in a higher power. He's a person. His name is Jesus. And he's not a thing. Ask them, what if that person loves you more than you could ever be loved? Because his name is Jesus. You know, here lately, because this evangelism is so in my heart, I love just passing by people, maybe in a parking lot or in a store, and just looking at them and getting that eye on them, and then just say, hey, did you know Jesus loves you? Because I know when I say those words, Jesus loves you, that I've touched something inside of them. Most of the time, I just get a smile. But the thing is, when I say that, could it be in their mind? It could be in their heart.
could be in their physical body. But they get that, I get that smile. Maybe because they know that it's a true statement. Or maybe they just needed to hear those words. To hear them words, Jesus loves you. You know, those are the three greatest words I think we could ever tell anybody. Jesus loves you. No matter what you're going through, Jesus loves you. No matter where you've been, Jesus loves you. He wants to come into your heart. He wants to come into your life. People need to know that. And church, we have Jesus in us. And we need to get it out to them. Life Church, we have got to get serious about evangelism. We have got to reach the lost. I'm here to tell you, you need to be in church next Sunday morning, because I really believe the anointing is going to fall. Let me tell you, I'm finished. It's going to be short today. I just want to share what was on my heart. And church, we can go forward or we can stay still, but we're never going back. I don't want to stay still. I want to go forward in all God has for us. He's everything to us. He's my hope. He's my life. He's everything. He has blessed me. He died for me. Why can't I live for Him? That's that simple. And I want to encourage you today, when you're in the parking lot, when you're going by, saying, just tell them, hey, look at them. I got blessed the other day going into, coming out of my car, to my car from Lowe's, and those ladies passed by, and I just looked, I said, you know Jesus loves you. And she just put this biggest smile. She said, yes, I do. You know how good that made me feel, that she knew Jesus loves her. And I'm going to get different responses, but the thing is, I'm going to respond with the love of Jesus back to them. That's what it's all about. My higher power is Jesus Christ. No cat, no president, no senator. My higher power is Jesus Christ. There is no one that's more higher than He is. And that person of Jesus lives in me. He lives in you. And He's going to go forward with all He has for us. So I'm excited. I can't wait to tell you what God has been showing me and the things that we're going to be start doing to get outside them church doors. Get ready. We're going to move forward. Can we pray right now? Father, right now in Jesus' name, I thank you for this time. I thank you for those who are watching, Father God. Lord, I hope they heard my heart that we can go forward in all that God has for us. And Lord, I just thank you that we're going to walk in your footsteps. We're going to be the church that you've called us to be. Lord, when you birth this church, you birth this church to go into the highway, the byways, and the hedges. And Lord, we're going to get back to that. We're going to go places. We're going to do things that you've called us to do. We're going to bring them into the house, Father God. And Lord, I just thank you and I praise you for all that you're going to do. Lord, again, I thank you for my Life Church family, how important they are to Gene and I, Father. And Lord, we pray for them every day, Lord. And I just thank you that miracles are going to begin to take place in their lives. Miracles are going to take place. I just sense right now in my heart, there's some miracles taking place in some homes right now. You may not feel it, you may not see it, but I'm here to tell you, it's there. That miracle, that wonder-working power of God. We're going to be like those four men, those four friends that had faith in the ability of God's power to heal their friend. And Lord, we just thank you right now that we're going to go out into this world. Look at it different. We're going to look at this world through Jesus' eyes and love on people, Father God. And Lord, I thank you and I praise you for all that you've done. I thank you for this word this morning, Father God. And I pray that lives have changed. And I pray that this radical spirit gets down inside of us, that we're ready to come to the house of God and lift our hands up, go straight to that altar and worship God. Say, let's get this praise going. Let's begin to worship God. I'm ready to go. We get down in that praise pit and we begin to praise God like we never have before. And Lord, I thank you for the excitement. I thank you for the anointing that's going to be that in our church, Father God, because the anointing and that encouragement and that excitement is inside of us, and we're going to bring it to the church.
We're going to bring it inside. And Lord, we pray for it to be contagious, Father God, and just begin to fall on others, Father God. And Lord, we give you the praise and glory. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Life Church, I love you guys. Listen, it's wet outside. It's slippery outside. So if you have to go out, be careful. And we love you. We'll see you Wednesday night at our service. Our midweek service. We're going to have a great time. Great teachings are coming forth. You need to be there. God loves you. I love you. And we just pray the best for you. Be safe and be warm. God bless.